So, next, one of my favorite pieces of all time is Rachmaninoff's Symphonic Dances. It's so fucking metal, you guys. It's so fucking good. Okay. Oh, that's from the beginning. It's like when the cauldron is like bubbling. Here we go. I'm just gonna wait till the end because it's so good. This part reminds me of Pirates. How can anyone not like that? I don't know. Who knows? Who the fuck knows? I don't know. All right. That was Rachmaninoff's Symphonic Dances, composed in 1940. And that was the third movement. So I'm always shocked to hear how recent Rachmaninoff composed all these works. You guys have to listen to all his stuff because it's just fucking gorgeous. Okay. All right, now. So that's 1940. Now I'm moving on to more modern times. So, who here loves watching movies? Yeah. So, a lot of movies and a lot of composers have included the Dies Irae into their movie soundtracks to show death. So this includes Star Wars, Game of Thrones, Groundhog Day, what's my list like? A Wonderful Life, The Mission, Star Wars especially, Lion King. Every single time there is death nigh, most likely you'll hear the Dies Irae in it. Ba-da-da-da-da-da-dum. So, I'm going to be playing a few clips of that, if I can find that in here. I have a lot of murder mystery podcasts on my phone, so I need to like sift through that. I'm just taking a selfie. Okay, hold on. It's in here. It's okay. Oops. Whoops. Okay. Just give me 1 second. Has anyone heard Cloverfield or the movie Cloverfield Lane? Has the deer in it? So this is Clockwork Orange. And this is The Shining. Exactly, right? So fitting. I should probably have a mask on. Yeah.
Tell me, Clarence.
It's a Wonderful Life.
Get me back. Get me back. I don't care what happens to me. Get me back to my wife and kids.
Indiana Jones. Close Encounters. Star Wars. Metropolis. Okay. Enough of that. Okay, so as you know, a lot of movies have the Dies Irae in it. I would say 90% of the time they will add the Dies Irae in it. It's just such a hallmark. Have you guys heard of the Wilhelm scream?
Yes,
it's like, it's really embarrassing. It's like, ah! You know, it's like every time you'll hear a scream, it's gonna be the same scream in like a lot of movies. It's everywhere. It's kind of like the Dies Irae to me. Every single time you hear that same scream, it's so funny how they asked the person to do the scream. It's like, you have to sound like you're in agony, pain, and then, but comedic. And so they just added that in like every single movie. So the Dies Irae is kind of the same to me. Every time I watch a new movie and there's death, I look for that Dies Irae in it. So, next. Now, a question is, do you feel like composers nowadays are stealing from past composers?
Yes, always, of course.
Do you feel like it's a good thing or a bad thing?
I think it's lazy, but it works because there's a reason they steal them, right? Because it fucking works.
It works, but what about patents?
But it's impossible not to. Like, you can write your own music that you don't. Think is completely original, and literally someone else will be like, this sounds like something else I've heard, and you don't put it together.
Yeah.
I think that there's a lot of that. I think there's like accidental stealing.
So do you think they should be fined for that?
So that are out of copyright. How do you feel about that?
That's a great question, and I'm about to get to that. I'm about to get to that.
Oh,
what do you think about composers nowadays stealing or borrowing or bettering?
Quoting.
Or what?
Quoting.
Yes.
Quoting.
Quoting. What?
Aren't they just remixing?
Remix it. Exactly. Exactly. So Glenn Gould is a perfect person. Yeah. It's a perfect example of that. Yes.
Why did you draw the line between being inspired and stealing?
Great question. And I feel like there's a lot of lawsuits today about when, actually, I'm going to get to that. So I'm trying to move a little faster because I tend to ramble on. Okay, so does everyone here know about the composer Stravinsky?
Yes.
So Stravinsky wrote Firebird, Petrushka, Rite of Spring, Pulcinella, and so many other great works. Amazing stuff. And he was from Russia and moved to Hollywood because he was huge. And then he had this conflict with Disney. So you guys probably have watched Fantasia. There's a dinosaur movie that Disney has done. And I don't think there's a movie of Petrushka that I know of. But anyway, so Stravinsky was huge and his rival was Schoenberg. They were friends though, it was fine. It's all mutual, amicable. So Stravinsky. So Stravinsky had wrote Firebird, Rite of Spring, Petrushka, and Disney has given him a contract saying, could we use your music for our movie? Now, they only offered him $5,000.
Boo.
Exactly, boo! Just imagine someone, $5,000 back then is about $100,000 now, which seems like a lot of money, but if your work, like example, Fantasia, it's extremely insulting. You don't really get royalties. It's like one-time pay, blah, blah, blah. So Disney, their publishing company was Boosey & Hawke, which is huge for music. I actually love their stuff. A lot of my stuff is Boosey & Hawke. But anyway, so they were protecting Disney. Stravinsky sued Boosey & Hawke, Disney, because he wasn't getting paid enough. So because of the copyright laws in Russia at the time, which was barely anything, and Stravinsky came to the US and was advertising his music, Disney felt like they were able to take advantage of his writing because there was no patent on his music. So they thought they weren't being dicks by offering him $5,000, but in today's time, only offering $100,000 for a movie like Fantasia that everyone fucking knows is kind of insulting. And so he sued Boosey & Hawke, or Disney, and Boosey & Hawke was the publishing company. Stravinsky felt like he had to concede because he felt like Disney was his chance of success. So he signed the papers, the contracts, and lost. So that's that, unfortunately. So now we're towards the end, guys. Okay. So I'm gonna play you guys this song, and I want, maybe you guys can name a classical piece that this sounds like. Okay.
Here's to the ones that we got.
Maroon 5. Is it stealing or borrowing? So, and this is. You get the idea. To me, it sounds exactly the same. so he's not getting sued. And then now, oh, this is such a good song, you guys. Okay. Okay. Ten points to the person who can guess this. Just, I didn't get the recording for this, but have you guys watched the movie Jaws?
Yes.
It goes bottom, bottom, bop, 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 bop. Now, Dvorak's Symphony No. 9 starts the same way. Bottom, 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 bottom. And that's where John Williams got the idea to pull Symphony No. 9 into Jaws. Now, the idea that Dvorak was trying to go for was the starting of a train, because it was during the Industrial Revolution. So it was starting of a train, but now it's sharks. I'm done. Thank you! This piece is so... Rachmaninoff's Piano Concerto No. 2, second movement. Such a good flute solo. Would you like to play it?
I'm here, let me play.
Yeah. It's electric shit.
What?
So. It's so good. Thank you. So, I'm pretty much done, but.